Nuclear fusion is often seen as the holy grail of clean energy, with the possibility to produce endless power to the world. However, there is a problem with nuclear fusion that doesn't seem to be discussed as often. In fact, some people even seem to be trying to keep it a secret. This issue is so big, it could mean all of the time and money spent on current nuclear fusion research is wasted. And as someone who wants nuclear fusion to work, it seems better to be transparent and work collectively to solve these challenges rather than pretending they don't exist. In this video, we'll look at the problem and explore the ways scientists are trying to fix it before it's too late. The fusion process combines two special forms of hydrogen, called deuterium and tritium. These are known as isotopes and have one and two neutrons, respectively. When these are packed together tightly enough for long enough, with temperatures around 6 times hotter than the sun's core, they can combine in a nuclear fusion reaction to create helium and a spare neutron. Now, this is where we start to run into issues. The first hydrogen isotope, deuterium, is abundant in our seas and supplies show no signs of stopping. In fact, it is estimated that there is enough deuterium to meet the power needs of Earth with fusion for millions of years. However, tritium is not so easy to get hold of, as there are practically no naturally occurring supplies of it. Therefore, our entire stockpile of 25 kilograms comes from some of the currently operating nuclear fission reactors, as for them it is an unwanted byproduct. Specifically, the tritium for nuclear fusion research comes from the 19 CANDU reactors in Canada, which filter out the unwanted tritium at a combined rate of 500 grams per year. As it turns out, this unwanted byproduct worked out pretty well for the owners of these reactors, as tritium has since become one of the most expensive things in the world, at over $30,000 per gram. That stockpile holding just 25 kilograms of tritium is a problem, as currently planned fusion reactors are gonna need a lot more than that. A major demand for this comes from the ITER project, which is an international nuclear fusion research and engineering mega project. This reactor is the most ambitious fusion project yet, and is expected to use around 12 kilograms of the available tritium. This is bad news for future projects such as the large demonstrator plants being designed by a number of different countries, as the tritium left won't be enough for them to operate. ITER's use of this tritium is made worse by the fact leftover tritium has a half-life of just 12.3 years, meaning our supplies are naturally halving every 12.3 years, and the Canadian CANDU reactors are set to slowly stop operating. So, is there a solution? The main way to combat this issue is through something called tritium breeding, in a tritium breeding blanket. This uses the spare neutron that gets shot off during the fusion reaction to create tritium, and if done properly, it can create more tritium than is used in the fusion reactor. This sounds too good to be true, so let's look at how it's done and what makes it so difficult. In an ideal world, the fusion reaction between the deuterium and tritium takes place and shoots off a neutron. This neutron flies through the first wall, which is a protective barrier to protect the tritium breeding blanket from the hot plasma, and then the neutron reacts with some beryllium. This reaction with beryllium causes the one neutron to turn into two neutrons, which then fly out to react with lithium and produce helium and tritium. Theoretically, this means up to 2 times more tritium than was used in the initial reaction could be produced. However, as we live in the real world, that's not quite possible. Firstly, there are side reactions happening that mean we don't always get as many neutrons as we want. Also, that first wall will block some of the much needed neutrons. And finally, some of the neutrons will fly out in the wrong direction and never even get to the tritium breeding blanket in the first place. Therefore, in reality, it is estimated that we'll be able to get around 1.1 to 1.2 times as much tritium out compared to what we put in, which is apparently just about enough to sustain the tritium supply for a fusion reactor when we account for other inefficiencies within the system. ITER will be the first reactor to try tritium breeding in practice, but due to budget cuts, it will only be a very small blanket covering less than 1% of the reactor's walls and operating purely as a research platform. Although it seems like mastering tritium breeding could solve the fuel shortages, there are a number of other challenges remaining. Firstly, this still means future reactors will not have enough tritium, as ITER will only produce a very small amount and supplies are already getting low. And secondly, the lithium in the tritium breeding blanket is not your average lithium. Specifically, this needs to be lithium-6. See, when we mine lithium, it is actually made up of two isotopes, lithium-6 and lithium-7. Unfortunately, lithium-6 is less abundant, as it only makes up around 7% of naturally occurring lithium. Therefore, it must be enriched to bump it up to 90% lithium-6. This enrichment process was possible at a plant in the US, which operated at the Oak Ridge National Laboratory in its Y-12 National Security Complex. It used a column exchange process called the COLEX process. However, this was actually banned in the US in 1963, with a 2013 report stating, Y-12 experienced several problems with the COLEX process, including equipment failures, worker exposure to mercury, and mercury contamination of the environment. Y-12 shut the COLEX facility down in 1963 and has not operated it since then. This begs the question, how will we get enough enriched lithium for the tritium breeding blanket? Well, a paper titled Development of a Viable Route for Lithium-6 Supply of Demo and Future Fusion Power Plants proposed a new process called ICOMAX, which would enable safe and sustainable lithium enrichment. This is still an active research project though, meaning it is yet to be proven at the required scale. So there appears to be options available for creating fusion reactors that can produce their own tritium, though some research and development is still needed. However, we still have one large problem left. How will these reactors start in the first place if we've already run out of tritium? One main idea is to start the reactors without tritium, and instead fuse two deuterium atoms. This is not a preferred reaction, as it is harder to achieve, but it could be used to create tritium in the breeding blanket, as it also releases a neutron after fusion. This is all, however, reliant on a good supply of lithium-6 and efficient tritium breeding blankets, so fingers crossed for the test blankets in ITER. The short supply of future tritium could also be a motivation for smaller reactors that don't require as much tritium to start up. Overall, this is no easy challenge, but as you can see, with each challenge, there are many scientists working on new solutions. In the meantime, check out this video on a fusion breakthrough and make sure to subscribe.